Hi, I'm Scott Giroux, and welcome to another episode of Power Apps Cafe. I've had a bit of a break from making videos because I've been doing loads and loads of PCF code components recently, really exciting stuff. But I am really happy here to be telling you about a very exciting new announcement, and that is the one of the preview for virtual controls. And I'm going to be showing you not only what those are, but also how to convert your existing standard controls into virtual ones. So stick around, cue the intro. So virtual controls then, what exactly are they? Well, it's actually a very, very long awaited feature that has been tantalizing us for a long time, and occasionally there's been little hints of them in the Power Platform CLI. But really, what they are doing is two parts. There's two parts to it. Firstly, is that we are allowed to now use the virtual DOM from the Power Apps host. And secondly, we're allowed to reuse libraries from the Power Apps host. So it's primarily about performance improvements, I would say. So at the moment, if you've been creating code components using React and using Fluent UI, which is indeed probably, I would say, one of the, not necessarily the best practice, but one of the most encouraged practices at the moment. At the moment, what happens is you've got the native controls, and they are all hosted inside the React virtual DOM. And what the React virtual DOM is basically it's a shadow DOM that there is a diff calculated with a physical DOM. And the idea is that performance gains can be had from that because it only updates the physical DOM when there's actually a change that's required, and because changes to the physical DOM can be expensive. And so what happens is that every time we have our custom controller, a PCF code component, it gets rendered on the Power Apps surface, it will instantiate its own virtual DOM. And so there's an overhead, obviously, that's going to be as part of that. And so if you've got 10 controls, that will be 10 virtual DOMs. But not only that, each time we create a code component and we use it in an app, so if we're using 10 different code components, the bundle that gets loaded will have its own version of React and its own version of Fluent UI bundle in there as well. So that increases the memory footprint. So with virtual controls, what's now going to be allowed to happen is that when we put our custom control onto the Power Apps design service, albeit it could be a custom page, it could be a model-driven app, it could be a canvas app, the same would happen. We're just simply going to be allowed to add our custom control into that parent React DOM, and therefore lower the performance implications. And then not only that, rather than bundling our own version of React and Fluent, we're just simply going to make use of the Fluent and React libraries that are already available to us. Of course, that does mean that we'll have to make sure that we match the same versions, and we need to take consideration as the versions change over time. We'll need to make sure that we're aware of that, but nevertheless, this is a long awaited feature, and I think it's going to make the opportunity to make our apps much, much more performant when we're using complicated and many, many different custom controls. So let's quickly look at how do we create one of those controls from scratch. The great thing is if you've got the Power Apps CLI or the Power Platform CLI installed, there's something called the Pack PCF init, and I'm sure you've probably used it, and that makes it very quickly to scaffold using a template. So if I create a directory here called virtual control, I've got already one of that. So virtual control 2, and CD virtual control 2. So I'm actually using the VS Code extension. So I'm not using the MSI installation of the Power Apps, the Power Platform CLI. So I can't use Pack PCF from here. I actually have to open up VS Code to do it. So I'm going to trust that. Yeah. And then I'm going to create a new terminal here. And now this gives us the ability to use Pack PCF init. And what that does is it's got, all of the parameters that we can provide, like, the namespace, the name of the control, the template, which could be field or data set. But this new parameter, the thing that's really the opening up the opportunity for us to do this is this framework parameter. And the framework parameter means that we're, as well as we can define it as a field or a data set, we can now say, okay, we'll actually use React as my template. So if I use that and just say pack PCF init virtual control, and if I use now this new framework, framework is the short form of that. And that can be, if you leave it off, it will just do the default standard control as before. But by specifying the framework as React, you can see what's going to happen now is it's going to create our code component and it's going to scaffold it as normal, but it's all going to be ready for you to create a TSX. And in fact, you can see here that it's got Hello World TSX already in the template. So, you know, it's off and running, but that's all well and good. But you've probably got existing code components. So how would you actually remove, or how would you change from a standard control to a virtual control? Well, the good news is that there really is not very much you need to do. It's very, very simple. And so I'm going to show you how to do that quickly. So let's go into I've already got existing component here. So if I say CD, I think it's called it my component. There we go. And I'll open that up in VS Code. And what that allows me to do now is I can, you know, see all of the various different files we've got here, and I've just got my component.tsx, and what that's doing is it's using a label. Just a Fluent UI React label, and it's just, you know, putting out some simple text. It's not doing something, anything massively different, right? You know, massively complicated. But if we go into our index.ts, what you'll maybe have not noticed up until now is that what this is doing is it's implementing something called standard control, which gives us all of the various different lifecycle methods that we need to do. So there's the standard control is what all of your controls will be using up until now. Equally, if you go into the manifest file, you'll see that the control type is standard here. So the first thing we want to do is we need to change that into a virtual control. But before we do that, if we look at this bundle.js, you'll see that we've got a whole load of stuff in here. Because remember, I was talking about the fact that when you're bundling code components, it's putting in both the React as well as the Fluent library. So even though this is a tiny little component, there's a whole load of stuff going on there. Now, we can optimize that by using things like deep path imports to only import the components we're using, or we can use tree shaking, but still we're going to have to bundle the things that we need, which is going to be at very minimum React and at very minimum the Fluent components that we need. So you've still got that kind of overhead there. So what we're aiming to do is to reduce that overhead. So by changing this to be a virtual control, it kind of tells the platform that, okay, it's going to be adding it to the virtual DOM of the parent app. But equally, we need to tell it that we are going to give it these, we need to take a dependency on the platform library. Now, this is quite interesting because what we're giving is a version of React and Fluent that we're going to take a dependency on. And of course, those need to match the versions that are made available to us at runtime inside Power Apps. So it's going to be interesting to see how this evolves. And do remember that this is a preview at this time, a public preview. So, you know, I think what will happen is we'll see, okay, there's this React version that's supported and this Fluent version that's supported, or a list of ranges of versions. And then over time, all those will be updated and we can just update our components accordingly. But nevertheless, we need to say in our manifest that we have to take a dependency on that platform library. So I'll save that and then go into our index.ts. And as I said before, we're using a standard control at the moment, but what we're going to do here is change this to be a React control. Really, this doesn't do very much apart from changes the method signature of update view. So before, update view would have returned just void. So now what we need to do is return a React element. And because in your existing implementations of update view, you will have been making a call to React DOM render. Okay, and what that's doing is that's creating that virtual DOM. You know, that's the virtual DOM we were just talking about. That's instantiated every single time your control is rendered on the form. And so rather than instantiating React DOM render, all we need to do is just simply return the element that we want to add to our React virtual DOM of the parent app. And then that simply gets inserted, and then all of the diffing between the virtual and the physical DOM will happen automatically. And then secondly, we just need to remove this destroy method functionality here, unmount, because we're not managing the virtual DOM, we don't need that unmount anymore, so we can get rid of that. So that's all we need to do to the actual index.ts. Now there's a third thing which is quite subtle, and that is if you have been optimizing, I mentioned before, you know, using deep path imports rather than importing from Fluent UI React, which would basically just bundle the entire of the React library. Or if you're using tree shaking, maybe that it won't. But by default, if you're using the standard pack PCF init templates, then it would have bundled the entire of that library. Well, you could have actually just simply used that, and so you could have imported just the label. Now, because we're now sharing this Fluent UI library of the parent, we don't need to worry about those kind of optimizations. So if you were using path-based imports, then you can just use the standard import from React, because it's not going to pull in the whole library. And that's all there is to it. So if I create a new terminal here, and now say npn start watch, and like this, what's going to happen now is it will build and create, update the bundle. And if we look at this bundle, we should see this bundle file now go down significantly, right? So it takes a bit of time to build, but now you can see that the bundle has just reduced in size considerably, right? We've just got my component there, and we've got index. We've got none of the other stuff that's needed. No React, no Fluent. But what we are seeing is this Fluent UI React, and with the version stamp there. So we can see that it's actually bringing in the library that's actually provided to us by the host app, as well as it's in bringing in the React library that's in from the host app. And you know, that's now going to have the same as we would normally see. It's going to be running it in the test harness. So the great thing is that the test harness works with these virtual controls as well. But of course, you won't really see any significant difference until you start to see it running inside your apps, and you'll see the memory footprint go down, and hopefully the performance will go up. So it really is that simple, converting your existing controls over to virtual controls. I would love to hear from you in the comments on your experiences on doing this. And remember, it's in preview, so maybe, you know, don't put it into production just yet. But yeah, please subscribe to my channel if you've not already, so you'll be notified about any future videos which I'm going to be doing on things like commanding V2. And yeah, until next time, have a great rest of your day. Cheers for watching.